Pierre-Alain Fouque and Pierre Karpman, and Thomas will give the talk.
Yep, thank you for the introduction. So, meet in the middle attacks have been commonly used in symmetric crypto, and somehow higher order have been a bit forgotten since the late 90s. So we've tried to come up with a united framework to use these two techniques for mounting preimage attacks on hash function. So we will start by basic recalls on hash function and preimage attacks. Then we'll present the Knelwolf and Hovatovich framework published at Crypto 12. And then we will see how we can merge these two, this previous framework with the notion of higher order differential, and then we'll attack the Blake family and the SHA-1 hash function. First, hash functions are basically functions that take arbitrary length binary word and compress them in fixed length binary word. So hash functions are widely used in cryptography and in various schemes such as hash and sign or MAC. An interesting aspect that we should want to have with hash function is the avalanche effect. So basically, if you just change a few bits in the input, you will have completely different outputs. So security notions used to measure security of hash function are roughly these three. So the collisions, the preimage resistance, and the second preimage resistance. Collisions are the fact of finding two different messages, M and M, such as their hash are the same. Preimage are given a specific hash, try to find a message so that its hashed is precisely the one you choose. And second preimage is when you take an arbitrary message, you hash it, and you want to find another message, such as its hash as the previous one. The security is measured with regards to the complexity of naive attacks, which are 2 over k over 2, thanks to the Bursey paradox for collisions. 2 to the k and 2 to the k, which is just as a brute force for preimage and second preimage. Let's talk a bit about the construction of hash function. When you take a one-way compression function, you want to conserve its security properties through a domain extender and then get a hash function. A common way to achieve that is to use the Merkle-Damgård scheme, which basically take a big message of whatever length, split it in chunks of equal size with binding if necessary, then give it to your compression function and with an IV. Then the result is given as the IV of the compression function as a second run, and then you give the second chunk and et cetera until you get your final hash. To construct a compression function, you can use a block cipher, and another common method to get your compression function is to use a Davis-Meyer mode. So you feed your block cipher with your message to hash as the key, and you give the IV as a message, and you XOR the result with the IV. So finding a preimage for this cipher will be equivalent to finding a preimage of H, which is equal to 6 or the IV, by the function where the IV is fixed and the key is the message. Let's suppose now that our compression function is splitted in 2 chunks, F1 and F2. Then doing a meet-in-the-middle attack will basically consist on guessing a key, guessing a message, do a computation in one direction, do the other computation in the other direction, and then, if you're lucky, if your guess is right, to have a match where you have done your split. In 2012, at Crypto, Knelwolf and Hovatovich has described the United Framework to mix meet-in-the-middle attacks, and differential attacks for preimage for preimage search for us function. So basically, the framework works as you take two subspaces in direct sum of in the space of messages. And for the sake of simplicity, we'll assume here that these two subspaces have the same dimension, which is n. And you will suppose that for every delta 1 in d1, it exists a big delta 1 such that for every message, this equation is fulfilled. It means that delta 1 is a message differential of probability 1. You will also require that the f2 minus 1 function verifies the same property for all the elements of d2, which is, again, the property of being of that for every element d2 exists a big delta 2, such that this is a differential, a message differential of probability 1. Now, we can wonder what happens if for a specific delta 1, delta 2, m plus delta 1 plus delta 2 is f is actually a preimage. Then we'll have this equation, thanks to the definition we gave of meet in the middle. And when using the differential property we impose on d1 and d2, we'll get from that equation this one for every message, for fixed messages, sorry. Then what you do is simply get the delta 1 here and then the delta 2 here, and we get this equation. Then we can remark that the left part only depends on delta 2, and the right part only depends on delta 1. So an idea one can have could be to store them in two lists, L1 and L2, which depends on only one parameter. So we get now an algorithm to test the presence of a preimage, which basically is you compute independently the two lists L1, L2. Then you look up for a common element. If you get it, you're happy, because since what we've just said, you will get the fact that m plus delta 1 plus delta 2 is actually a preimage. If you're not, you're not that happy, but what you can say something really interesting is that precisely the affine subspaces here, m plus delta 1 plus m plus d1 plus d2, doesn't contain any preimage. So in terms of complexity, you will have, if we call by c1 and by c2, the cost of one call to the function f1 and one call to the function f2, the computation of the L2 list will cost 2 to the n c1. I recall that the dimension of the space d2 and space d1 are n. So we have 2 to the n call to make, 2 to the n call to make. This list has a size 2 to the n, this list has a size 2 to the n, so you can look up for a common element in 2 to the n. Then, for a cost of 2 to the n c1 plus 2 to the n c2, you can test 2 to the n message. You can test if among 2 to the n message you get a preimage. So the point is that it's not sufficient, because you want if you want to find a preimage, you will have to test a volume, a total set of cardinality 2 to the k, if k is the length of your hash. Therefore, you will have to launch again and again and again your algorithm, and you have to launch it 2 to the k minus 2 n times. Therefore, the final complexity of the attack you mount is 2 to the k minus n multiplied by the cost of one call to the compression function. Let's go back a bit in time, and in 94, when independently Lai and Knudsen introduced generalization of differentials, which are higher order differential. So let's go back with the previous equation. Let's suppose that for a specific delta, a specific couple delta delta, and for a sufficient set of messages, this equation holds. This means that this equation is fulfilled with a certain probability. You will say that delta delta is a differential. Then if you rewrite it, just taking the fm into the other side, you will see that this quantity is a finite difference operator. Then you can rewrite your equation like that. And what you can do with finite difference operator is to compose them. And then recursively, you can compose anytime you want finite difference operator. The point is, for instance, when you just take two difference operator and you compose them, let's say dA, dB, you get an operator dAB. When you evaluate it on a message, you will get the first translation with regards to A, the translation with regards to B, the translation with regards to A, so B, and the translation with regards to M, and another translation, sorry. Then you will ask that the probability of that the equation dAB of FM is equal to a certain specific delta is fulfilled with a certain probability. You will say that AB delta is an order two message differential of probability P. And we will use that to mount attack with order differentials. So now we will no longer have two subspaces, but now four, D1, D2, D3, D4. And we will ask for every delta one, delta three in D1, D3, that for every message, this equation is fulfilled, which means in the language we just introduced that delta one, delta three to zero is an order two message differential of probability one. Here you can notice that we take an output difference of zero. We can do it with non-zero difference, but it will make just the equation a bit longer. So we just, for sake of simplicity, use that case. And once again, we will suppose for the sake of simplicity in the analysis of complexity that all the subspaces have dimension n. So we will impose that this equation is also fulfilled for every element d2, d4. It's a symmetric. And previously, when we were asking for the presence of a preimage, we'll say, OK, we want f1 of m plus delta 1 plus delta 2 is equal to this quantity. Now we will ask for this equation to be fulfilled. And we again used the property imposed on d1, d2, d4, d3, d4. And we will get that kind of equations. And now what we can see is that here, this quantity depends on three indices, this one, and this one, and these two quantities depend on two indices. So we can have a similar algorithm. We can store all these quantities in six lists, and what we will do is basically compute them independently, like before, look up for d1, d2, d3, d4 that fulfills a previous equation. And then if you're lucky, you get a preimage which is m plus d1 plus d2 plus d3 plus d4. If not, bad luck, but you don't care because you can say also something interesting, which is that this big affine subspaces doesn't contain a preimage. So in terms of complexity, again, what you will do is you have to compute all this list. Here, the delta 3 can be chosen among 2 to the n different elements. And so here you will have 2 to the 3 n called to the function f1 to do. Here the same and etc. What you will do is, if you can compute the lookup at all efficiently, and you can in the precise case we are attacking for Sherwin and Blake, you will get this complexity for testing 2 to the 4 n messages. Which is basically 2 to the 3n of the cost of the hash of a call to the hash function. So once again, it's not sufficient if n is not sufficiently big. What you will do is just to relaunch the whole previous algorithm 2 to the k minus 4n times, and at the end, you will get a total complexity of 2 to the k minus n call to the hash function. So at this point, you can say, OK, if I'm really lucky, I can find lots of differentials. What do I really gain by doing higher order differential attacks? Because you can see here that in the best case, what you will gain is a factor three quarter. Whereas when you do order one differentials, you can gain at most a square root. So you are thinking, okay, it's great, it's more complicated, and the results are worse. So what's the point? The point is that if you see differentials as like derivatives in mathematics, you will lower the algebraic degree of the function you are considering. And by using order two differential, you are indeed doing a differential or a function which has a degree which is lower by one of the degree of the function you are interested in. Therefore, you can find that the function is somehow have a smoother behavior, and you are more likely to find higher probability differential when you're using order higher differential. And for that reason, you can find, if you're lucky, some order 2, order 3, I don't know what, order n differential, when for any reason, simple order differential doesn't simply exist. So that's the reason why it can be useful. So now, let's do fun things and let's break some functions. So SHA-1, we'll recall it briefly because Pierre did it in a previous talk. It's part of the MD4 family. Its hash size is 160 bits, so the preimage secret is same amount of bits. Message blocks are 512 bit long. It's a block cipher in Davis-Meyer mode, and the structure is a 5-branch RxFast tail with linear message expansion. Here is the round turn. So, the result. We get 62 rounds attacked over 80 with two blocks and a correct padding with a complexity which is not trivial, but close to the brute force. But the previous results were made by Knellwolf and Hrovatovic in 2012. And what we did is, on the one hand, we get further in the number of rounds, but also for the same amount of rounds, we lower the complexity by a factor 2. With one block and a correct padding, we managed to get 4 rounds further in the attack, and for the same amount of rounds, we lower by a factor almost 4. And in pseudo preimage, which means that you allow the attacker to choose the IV, which allows you to be more flexible in the attack. We managed to attack 64 rounds in pseudo preimage with a complexity. This complexity. And the previous result, still in Knellwolf and Horatrovic paper, were 60 rounds. So on the overall, the introduction of high order differential allows us to get further in the attack and to lower the complexity of the rounds previously attacked. We also applied the framework to the Blake family, the Blake hash family function, Blake and Blake 2. So Blake was a SHA-3 finalist. Blake 2 is a faster version of the function. Both of them were designed for high performances. Blake have two versions, which are namely Blake 2 56 and 2512, which works on 32 and 64 bits words. Blake 2 have two versions, which are Blake 2B, Blake 2S, which Blake 2B corresponds to Blake 512, and Blake 2S corresponds to Blake 256. So the run function of Blake and Blake 2 are not have a similar shape, which, if you represent the internal state with 4-4 matrix, it will first operate on rows and then on columns, and then operates on diagonals, and you will do that twice to obtain a round. So, the results. We've managed to get a bit further in the attack of the Blake function with the IV fixed. Because the IV is somehow very continuous in Blake, so we gain slightly a quarter of round with a complexity of 2510. But if we attack in pseudo preimage and we don't care about the initialization, we manage to attack respectively 6 and 3/4 of rounds on Blake 2S and Blake 256, and we managed to attack 7.5 on Blake 512 and Blake 2B, with complexity which are quite close to the brute force attacks. So it's still really theoretical attacks. That's all, folks.
Thank you very much.